welcome to the worship of God at First Baptist Church, Weaverville. We are so glad that you have joined us in worship today from wherever you are watching. You are most welcome here. And indeed, we are all together as the Holy Spirit connects us all. And you'll be hearing me mention that many times during our worship service today. We have a very special service planned. As always, we continue to have our worship in this fashion, and you can get all the updates for things like worship services, announcements, prayer concerns, encouragements, community resources. You can find all of that on our church's Facebook page, on the blog, on our website, and through our regular email updates. So if you're not getting regular email updates with encouragements and with thoughts and tips, feel free to send a message to info@fbcwvl.org. All the information for the worship service today will be found in the description below of this video. So you might need to click on Show More to reveal things like the order of worship will be copy and pasted in the video descriptions, as well as links to the hymns that we'll be singing, lyrics to the choruses that we'll be singing, and links to the two scripture passages which we will be reading. Like I said, today is a special day on the Christian calendar because it is the Sunday before Easter, so it is Palm Sunday. Later on in the service, we'll be reading the story of when Jesus rode into Jerusalem to cheers and to waving palms and to lots of excitement. So, we will be celebrating Palm Sunday in this different kind of medium today. After our worship, we will, as we do every year, plant a cross in our churchyard outside. So you will see a video of that brief ceremony to watch as well. Even though we cannot gather in person, we still worship and we still enjoy the blessings together that God gives us. So Palm Sunday is one of those blessings. Also today, this is when we had planned to share communion together and have the Lord's Supper in our worship service. So we will do that as well. I encourage you to find something in your house that you can use to participate in the Lord's Supper later in our service. Something simple to eat, like a piece of bread or a cracker. Something simple to drink, like grape juice or milk or water. Whatever you have on hand, you are invited to participate, and we will all share in the Lord's Supper together later in our worship service. In a moment, the prelude music will begin, and I encourage you to do a few things during that time. First, pass the peace of Christ. If you are blessed enough to be inside with someone, with a loved one right now, then be sure to tell them that you are thankful for them. If you are by yourself, then make plans to reach out, either by phone call or by note or message to someone else so that you can share some peace with them as well. Also, get any resources you might need for a worship service, like the food and the drink for communion. And then when you are ready, sit quietly, listen to the prelude music, and focus your heart and your thoughts for worship today. Let us begin.
And now we sing, "All glory, laud, and honor," for our Palm Sunday processional hymn. We usually have our children coming down the aisle waving the palm branches, if you can imagine that. And children, we miss you, but we hope that you send in your videos and we will see some of you waving palm branches at a later time in our service. But now may we sing all stanzas of "All glory, laud, and honor."
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord.
At this time, we'd like to invite all of our children to gather to their screens so that they can join us for our children's time. Good morning, children. Today in our service, we will be celebrating communion and the Lord's Supper. You all know that typically when we gather together at church during children's time, we have our love feast when the church does communion. And I'm sorry that we're not going to be able to do that today. I know how much you all enjoy that. But today, we'll be able to celebrate that with your family, and that's really special too. And I wanted to share with you a story that reminded me of Jesus sharing the bread and the wine with his disciples, the love feast that he shared with his disciples reminds me of my favorite blanket that I brought to share with you today. This is my favorite blanket, and it's got a really cool story that goes with it. I come from a family that loves to give really big hugs. And when I was a little girl, my mom would give me a big hug every night before I went to bed. Every night before I went to sleep, she would wrap her arms around me, she'd give me a big bear hug, and she would tell me how much she loved me before I went to sleep. And she would also give me a big hug every morning before I went to school and every time I left the house. If I went to my grandparents to spend the night, or if I went to my friend's house, or any time I left, I would get a big hug and she would tell me that she loved me. And she did this every single day. I would get at least one, if not multiple, big hugs. So when I turned 18, I was a senior in high school and I got accepted to a college that was a couple of hours away. And so my mom knew that I was going to be moving away, and that for the first time in my life, for 18 years, she knew that it would be days, weeks, and sometimes even months before she would see me again, before I would be able to get a hug from her, before she would be able to wrap her arms around me and tell me that she loved me. And that made her sad. And it made me sad too. And so she thought of a way that she could show me that she loved me even though she was far away from me. And so she took these little white squares, she cut out a fabric, and she went to all of my friends and my family members and all the people at church, and she gave them each one, and she gave them some Sharpie markers, and she let them write little messages to me. And some of them drew pictures, and some of them wrote Bible verses on them. So my teachers from school, and my Sunday school teachers, and all my friends from church, and my family members each did a different square. And she took them, and she sewed them together with thread and with love, and she surprised me with this beautiful quilt at my graduation party. And she said to me, she said, when you're away at college and you get sad and lonely, I want you to take this quilt, and I want you to wrap it around your shoulders, and I want you to feel the hugs and the love of all the people that are here today. And I want you to know that even though we're far apart, we are all together in our hearts. And I want you to feel that love, even though you're sad. And this reminds me of Jesus and his disciples, because even though he was gonna leave them, see, when Jesus met with his disciples, he knew that he was gonna have to leave them for a little while. He knew that he was gonna die in a few days, and that very soon, and that his disciples weren't gonna get to see him for a little while, and that they were gonna be sad. And he wanted to give them something, something they could touch that would remind them of him. And so he took some bread, and he took a cup, and he shared it with them. And he said, I want you to meet together after I'm gone. I want you to share these things with one another, and I want you to remember me, and I want you to love one another. And then do this until we're together again. And so, just like my blanket, the cup and the bread was a way for them to hold each other in their hearts, even though they were far apart. And so friends, I know that we've been separated from loved ones these past few weeks, and that it's been really hard, and we have all kind of feelings about that, and that's okay. Sadness is a part of life sometimes, but Jesus gave us a way that we can deal with that. And so I want you to think of somebody right now that you're missing. And I want you to think of something that you used to do with them. Maybe there was a book that you used to read together, a recipe that you used to cook, a game you used to play, a toy, an object, something that you can do or hold that reminds you of them. And I want you to see if you can do that this week. And I know it's not the same. The blanket was not meant to replace my mother's hugs, and the bread and wine does not replace Jesus's presence in their lives. But it was a way to remember and a way for us to deal with some of these emotions while we are apart. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we're sad. There's a lot of people we miss, and there's a lot of things we miss. But we thank you for giving us a way to hold people in our hearts until we can hold them in our arms once again. Amen.
And now we will sing together a medley of some of our favorite hymns, very familiar hymns, centered on the cross. And once again, you'll find these words in your order of service that is on the link there for your bulletin.
Thank you.
At this time in worship, we make it a point to give back. It is important to recognize that because we have been given so much in life, then we too must give back to help in God's work in building God's kingdom here and around the world. So during the offertory music, I encourage you to either make plans to give and donate and contribute, or while the music plays, you can go on our church's website, fbcwvl.org, and click on donate at the top to give a tithe and an offering and a contribution. Those are needed now more than ever, because this church, like so many other services, is trying to reach out to people in our community to hear what the needs are now that are greater than ever. So I encourage you during this offertory time to make it a point to plan or to give and to make a difference. May God bless the offerings that we can give today.
Yeah.
At this time, we will pray for each other to the Lord. So if there are specific prayer needs that you have, then you are invited to let us know. We would love to have the honor of praying to God with you and for you. You can send us an email, a message. You can call the church and leave a message at 645-6720. We can speak out loud prayer concerns in worship, or we can hold unspoken requests in our hearts as we pray throughout the week. We are here for you. In this difficult time, we all must be here for each other. So do let us know how we can be praying for you these days. I will begin our prayer time, and then I will leave space open in the middle for you to voice your own prayers to God or to listen to what God has to say to you today. And because this is a video, then you can pause it at that point and pray as long as you need to. You can be as loud as you need to, or as quiet as you want to be. Whatever is on your heart, take that moment and share it with God. And listen to the prayer that God has for you today as well. And then you can resume the video and I will conclude our prayer time. Let's pray. O God, we do give you thanks for a new day. Even though our days are filled with stress and with worry and with uncertainty, nevertheless, let us never take for granted the gifts and the blessings that we have received. Let us always be thankful for what we have. For those who are healthy today, we give you thanks, O God, for that health. Now more than ever, we realize the blessing of good health. We pray that those who are healthy may stay that way for a long, long time. And for those who are in ill health today, we pray for them. Maybe they are indeed battling the virus now or other long-term conditions. Whatever is plaguing and hurting people today, we pray for their physical condition. We pray for their breathing, for their strength, for their heart, for their mind, for their body, and for their soul. We pray for them. If we were to begin listing the names of all the folks whom we worry about today, we might never stop. So we are grateful, God, that you know the names of every person on this earth who needs extra prayers and extra support today. We pray also, O God, for ourselves. Some days it feels like we are just a walking bundle of worry. We feel tight and heavy. We are anxious and nervous. So God, I pray that we would remember your invitation when Jesus told us to cast all of our concerns onto him because he cares for us. So let us do that today, O God, for our concerns are many and our cares are heavy. We take time now in prayer to share them all with you. Lord, hear our prayers today. The times where we don't even know what to pray for. Remind us that you do. So we can always pray that your will would be done and that your kingdom would come here on this earth that needs it very much, just as it is in your heaven. In your name we pray. Amen. In our scripture text today, Jesus enters Jerusalem for the Passover feast. And it was such an important holiday that the Old Testament commanded all Jews to return to Jerusalem to celebrate it, if at all possible. So, Jews from all over the world would have been in the city at this time for a feast that lasted a week. It would be as big as if our entire holiday season from Thanksgiving to Christmas all took place in just one excited week, and all of us in the same city. That's the kind of crowd and energy and excitement that is going on in our text today. So lots of people from all over would have been there. They would have been attending different church services at the temple. They would have been seeing friends and family members that they hadn't seen all year, singing special Passover songs as they celebrated. So that is the level of excitement in the air. Then, when Jesus enters the city, he makes this big entrance. This is a reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 12, verses 12 through 18. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Blessed is the King of Israel!" Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it, as it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." At first, Jesus' disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. May God bless the reading of this holy word today. It's always so interesting reading Bible passages at different times in life and in different seasons and thinking, noticing different things. It's strange to read this kind of passage now because I don't know about you, but I have become so trained these days that reading about a big crowd scrunched in together sends my alarm bells off. And I think, oh no, think of the contagion and the germs, because that is the mindset that we have come to live in these days. So let us free ourselves from that mindset for a moment as we think about and enjoy this passage. They would not have had to worry about any kind of coronavirus back then. They were just excited. So excited that they couldn't help but shout out loud, "Hosanna!" as Jesus rode by. Hosanna is a Hebrew phrase from the Old Testament that means something like a combination between "praise the Lord" and "help me Jesus" at the same time. It's something that you would shout when you were excited about God's work and you really wanted to be a part of it and for God to save you. The other thing the crowd shouts is, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And that's from the psalm that Kathy read earlier in our service, from Psalm 118. So the crowds are quoting the Old Testament in their cheers. They're singing songs from back in the good old days when Israel had a king and was strong. Here in the New Testament, Israel is under the control of the Roman Empire. So the people are hoping for someone who will march in and be their new strong king. Maybe this Jesus is the guy, the crowds think. So blessed is the King of Israel, they shout to him. Maybe he's the man. These crowds, these desperate people, expect God's long-awaited Savior to burst onto the scene and march right into Pontius Pilate's office, the governor appointed by Rome, kick him out, and all the other Roman soldiers with him. Then the Messiah would establish a new golden age for Israel with power and military might. That's what the crowds were excited about as they cheered. And I think Jesus' disciples were probably excited too. They're thinking, wow, people are cheering. They're finally getting on board with our movement. We gave up everything to follow Jesus, and now finally it's paying off. We can't lose. It's only getting better from here. That's because, as our scripture text noted, the disciples didn't fully understand what was happening at the time. Only afterwards did they finally figure out that Jesus' mission involved not a military takeover, but the ultimate sacrifice. So I wonder, would the disciples and the people in the crowd have cheered so loudly if they knew that Jesus was riding to a cross instead of an earthly kingly throne? This happens on Sunday, Palm Sunday. As the week goes on Thursday, he's arrested and beaten and given a show trial, then executed by Friday. Where were all those cheering supporters then? It's easy to cheer in the middle of a fun, excited crowd, but it's harder to praise in the face of death, or when your leader is being mocked and abused. It's harder to cheer when you're all alone. It was as if each day that week, the palm branches that had started so high slowly lowered as the week went on, and little by little, people put down their palm branches, let them fall by the wayside, and went on with their lives. By the end of the week, even Jesus' most favored disciple, Simon Peter, denies ever knowing him, fearing a guilt by association kind of persecution. Then, of course, on Easter morning, when they finally see and understand that Jesus has conquered death itself, they get all excited again. I'm sure on Easter Sunday, some of the disciples gave Jesus a great big hug and said, "Oh, I'm so glad you're back, Jesus. I never doubted you for a minute." And Jesus would have said, "Oh, really? Do you still have your palm branch? I didn't see you around during the crucifixion." And maybe they'd say, I was far in the back. You didn't see me. Fortunately, Jesus would have forgiven those disciples and everyone in the crowd for conveniently losing their palm branches and their praise when he was arrested and abused. He forgave them for the choice that they made. When faced with challenge or persecution, they chose the easy way out, and they stayed silent. We can understand that, I think. It's a very common temptation that we give into. We want to avoid an awkward situation, maybe. Choosing to stay quiet instead of speaking out. Just letting some things go and hoping it's okay. We've all done it. Taking the easy way out instead. Let me give you a bad historical example of that, which had consequences. It's the legend of Moses' robes. And like all legends, its accuracy might be a little debatable, but it is a legend nonetheless. Moses Rose was born in France around the year 1785. He joined the French army, rose to a high rank, and saw a lot of combat during the Napoleonic Wars. He was involved in great victories, but also great defeats, and saw the loss of many lives. When he was 30 years old, Moses Rose immigrated to Texas, which was still Mexican territory at the time. And then when he was 50, the Texas Revolution started. So, being an experienced officer, he volunteered. He was a friend of Jim Bowie, so Moses Rose accompanied Bowie to the Alamo. Eventually, as we know, the Alamo was surrounded by Santa Anna's army, which vowed to kill all of the soldiers who remained inside. The Texan commander, Colonel Travis, drew a line in the sand with his sword and asked anyone who was willing to stay and defend the Alamo to step over and cross the line, even though they would most likely be killed. As the legend goes, every soldier stepped over the line except Moses Rose. He didn't want to face a slaughter like the ones he had seen in previous battles. So he said, "I am not prepared to die, and I shall avoid it if I can." During the night, he leapt through a window and fled. The next day, on March 6, 1836, Santa Anna's army attacked, and all the soldiers in the Alamo were killed. But of course, those who stayed and fought that day are remembered forever as heroes for their courage and bravery. Moses Rose, however, he made it back to his home in Nacogdoches, Texas, but he was forever known as the coward of the Alamo, because he chose to save his life instead of serve his duty when the going got tough. He chose to take the easy way out. So, here we are on Palm Sunday. We have sung and cheered for Jesus. But what will you do when things quiet down? Will you give thanks to God when you're all by yourself? We can't be in church with each other these days, so will you still worship with passion even when no one is watching? Or what about the opposite? Will you still demonstrate the love of Christ if you are in a crowded place these days? We definitely have to distance ourselves physically, but it's tempting to distance ourselves in every other way as well. To look at others with fear and judgment. To ignore instead of greet others with kindness. To look after your own needs, your own supplies, instead of helping other people in need as well. It's easy to follow Jesus when everyone is cheering together and there's nothing to be afraid of. But when we're all afraid of strangers and their germs, will we find creative new ways to communicate love? Or will we take the easy way out and shelter even our hearts in place? Palm Sunday is exciting. But who will still be praising and serving God when the going gets tough? Let us pray. Oh God, I do pray that you would fill us up with the courage and the energy of cheering, praising crowds so much that we carry it with us through these difficult days. We will need that courage and energy. For when we are alone by ourselves, it is tempting to let our faith go soft. If we have to go out and about, it is tempting to recoil at every soul whom we see. So we will need your energy and your cheers, O God, to support us and to motivate us during these days. May we live and stand strong, always praising you, even when the going gets tough. Amen. And now is the time that we will share in the Lord's Supper together. Share and together are the key words of this meal, this Lord's Supper that is shared in communion with everyone, because we all receive and are nourished by the gifts of God. This meal reminds me of something that we all need to remember at all times, but especially these days. We are all connected. You know, I heard that phrase just a couple of days ago from the Buncombe County Health Director. She said, "We are all connected." I think as a society, we forgot that. We started self-isolating a long time ago. But this virus has reminded us with a vengeance that we are all connected, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health. The coronavirus is the worst of being connected. But this holy meal, this is the blessing of being connected with each other, because we all share it. All around the world, Christians have shared this meal together for hundreds and hundreds of years. And you know what? We have not had this meal in the same building with our brothers and sisters in Europe or Africa or Asia or South America. And yet, we were all connected. This communion meal has always been shared from a distance, virtually. So now that is true more than ever. We are still all a part of the body of Christ, even if we are in different buildings and different homes. So that is not different. Although, of course, we are doing things different for our communion today. We took all the precautions of sanitation and cleanliness to make sure that everyone could stay safe and healthy. So I invite you, wherever you are watching this, in your homes, to share in it as well, with whatever food and drink you can find. A simple cracker or piece of bread, maybe a homemade baked loaf of bread like Jesus might have shared. Something simple to drink, like the grape juice we use here, or like wine that Jesus would have used, or water or milk. Whatever it is, the food item and the drink doesn't matter, because the power of this meal is not in the food and the drink. The power comes in us all doing it together with each other and with Christ. That is where the power comes from, when we share it with each other. So I invite you to share in this meal that feeds both the body and the soul. Know that all who seek Christ are welcomed at God's table. Let us pray to focus and to prepare our hearts to receive God's gift. Let's pray. Holy God, in your infinite power and love, you made us. When we had fallen into sin and selfishness, you gave to us your Holy Son, Jesus the Christ, to share our humanity, to live and die as one of us, and to show us the way to salvation. May we receive that salvation by accepting his grace and your love today. Amen. On the night that he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is like my body, which has been broken for you. Whenever you eat this, do so in remembrance of me." The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he poured it, and he shared it with his disciples, saying, "Take, drink. This is like my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do so in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. By this we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray and give thanks. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food through the symbols of his body and blood. Help us then to live in the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with glad hearts through Christ our Lord. Amen. At this point in our service, I invite you to respond to the message that God has spoken to you today, or to the blessings that you have felt today. One way that we respond is in song, by singing our hymn of response, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." But I also encourage you to figure out what your response will also be on top of that. You can take time to think about it as we sing. You can sing with us, or hum, or look at the words as the music fills your soul. But think of a way that you will respond this week. Our hymn of response is "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." We will sing stanzas 1, 2, and 4. Joining us in worship today from wherever you are, and on whatever day you are watching this. Your participation and your presence is a blessing to this place and to the Lord, and we are thankful for it. Even though we are not in the same building, the Holy Spirit connects us all. So be sure to stay connected. That is so important these days. Make sure that you're staying connected to the encouragements and announcements that the church sends out and posts every week through email and Facebook and on our website. Look for those encouragements, because if there's one thing we need these days, it is encouragement and to know that we are not alone. So now, may the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may the Lord hold you in the palm of his hands. Remember that you are not alone. You are loved by God and by us. Be healthy in body and in spirit. Amen. Now let us sing our benediction song together.